Today's platform speaker is leader Curt Collier. Curt is the leader of the Ethical Culture Society of Bergen County and a passionate advocate for community redevelopment. He works as a consultant, helping nonprofits enhance their capacity to make a positive impact. Additionally, Curt is a professor of ethics in science at Fairleigh Dickinson University, and serves as a community planning specialist for the National Park Service. He leads various initiatives, including job training programs for New York City schools, support for environmental nonprofits in New Jersey, and projects aimed at improving scientific literacy among young adults. Curt is also the consulting leader for the Ethical Culture Society of Silicon Valley and the Austin Ethical Society. Please join me in welcoming Curt Collier.
Well, hey, and good morning. How are all y'all? Now I have to live up to Liz's big introduction. Like, oh my God, no pressure there. Thank you, Liz. How are you? Good to see all of you. I love all of you. I love this space. I love everything about ethical culture, of course. Most everything about ethical culture. I decided probably around August that the election was going to turn out the way it was. And so when they asked me what I wanted to talk about, I chose the title for today because I figured this is what was going to happen because it's part of a larger trend across the United States. And I don't mean to chastise or blame. That's completely not worth our time. We certainly don't want to demonize other people. Those are the tools of tyrants, not of visionaries. Instead, what we need to do is to come in wide-eyed and open. We've seen bad men before, right? I mean, I was raised in a place where I saw them all the time. You're going to see them again. They're going to come in and do this stuff, and we will continue to resist and continue to move the march forward. So what I want to do today is just give you some ideas, right? Just some things to think about and how we can get organized to move ourselves forward. Because what's happening to progressive movement in the United States is it's actually bucking several trends that are kind of going on nationwide that we need to be aware of and that we need to think about. I have to tell you that, yeah, I teach philosophy, I'm an ethical culture leader, but at heart, I'm a contractor, I'm a builder, I teach construction, you know, I do rock walls and things like that. And I always tend to think of those very concrete, contextual, just do these things, transform the place and see what happens. Change the context. And that's what I often focus on. We are a highly contextual species. And we forget our own biology, the deep biology of our own selves sometimes, and how we respond so much to context. We become so impassioned of the life of the mind and reading and books and films and things like that, which is great, which is the great legacy of the Enlightenment that we continue to carry forward, that we also forget sometimes the brick and mortar type of things that need to be done. And no fault of our own. I'm not blaming anyone or anything like that. I just want to talk about where we go forward, how we do this, why I kind of predicted this was going to be the turnout, and in my work. So I consult with lots of different groups across the United States, continue to do that. I am a community planner specialist for the National Park Service in addition to doing all the work that I'm doing here. And the work I did is to kind of think of the context, the building, the spaces that we put people in. So I come at these things from a very pragmatic, this is some things we need to do. And later on, I'm hoping you'll engage with me in discussion. We could have done lots of things. Things could have come out differently. We can analyze these things to death, which is important. I think we can do that. We're intelligent people, and it's great exploring ideas. But I just want to kind of highlight three or four things that I think we can pay attention to. The first is the big national trend and the drop in civic engagement in the United States, which has plummeted for years. How many of you remember the book Bowling Alone by Robert Putnam or have heard people go on and on about it? Right, so Bob Putnam, sociologist around year 2000 published a book called Bowling and Loan, in which he said, what's interesting is he saw this plummeting beginning to happen in civic engagement in the United States. There were no more bowling leagues. People were bowling alone, hence the title of his books. And he kind of wanted to study this. And he looked across the United States, you know, where's the Moose Lodges, the Elks, the Knights of Columbus, the, you know, all of these different groups. He went to Rotary clubs and all this kind of stuff, local choral groups and library groups. And he looked across the United States and looked at this and saw them plunging back in the year 2000. And he thought, wow, that's really interesting. And so he looked across and he said, no, some groups are holding their own and they're doing quite well. And they continued to kind of continue on. And so Bob Putnam looked at those groups and found that they tended to be very conservative leaning, church going people, and who tended to tell their children, listen, you're going to come to church on Sunday mornings. You're going to participate in this religion that we have, you're going to volunteer your time and you're going to do these things. He then looked at progressive groups at the time and they were saying, hey man, break free, tune in, turn on, drop out. You know, not the, that was the 60s, but by the time the year 2000, that find your own bliss, find your own way in the world. And so Bob made a prediction of where those groups would be in about 20 something years later, which is where we find ourselves today. And he says, well, participation in civic organization really is something that is a skill. You participate in it, you find your talking points, you come together on a routine basis, just like you do here on the coming together on a Sunday morning. You are an outlier, the fact that you're even here in this room, and I'll mention that in a second. And so he looked at those groups and he says, the progressive groups would have much less influence on future politics around the year 2025, 24 somewhere, than conservative groups who would have stayed organized, getting their talking reports, funding themselves, raising millions of dollars for something like the Heritage Foundation that put out that heinous document, Project 2025, and so on. And progressive groups would find themselves like, whoa, just what happened? And Rob Putnam, by the way, just recently released a new film. It's called Join or Die. Now, he's not being dramatic that, you know, the Huns are at the door. What he means is that the fact that you are participating in a group adds years to your life. He looked at all the data about people and their civic engagement and found that the more people who are more civically engaged live much longer lives, and has kind of explored that data. But we have seen a massive drop in civic engagement, especially amongst what Liz mentioned, the progressive groups in the United States. Now you think that's not possible. I see these massive type of stuff. You see massive events that are organized one period of time where people show up for those events and then disappear for all the other hard work that has to happen. The committee meetings, the getting together, showing up in those places, all those other types of events. So we've seen a tremendous drop in civic engagement. In fact, the number of people who are participating in congregations, even in the 90s, was up around 76% of Americans joined a congregation. What percentage of Americans join congregations today? 33%. Yep. And even they say, well, we think it's actually now even lower than that, the drop off. What's the volunteer rate? It used to be around 46% of Americans actively volunteered each year to participate in it. What has that dropped down according to the recent study by AmeriCorps? It's 23%, not that bad. 23% of Americans volunteer their time until you get to New York, New Jersey area where it plummets to 16%. 16% of people are volunteering. Now, that's not the same thing as saying, well, I take my stuff to the, you know, my used clothes or the stuff. That's one kind of civic engagement, right? That those levels Americans are still participating in. But showing up at a meeting and participating in something and engaging in the group and trying to get at a group of activists, that has dropped as well. So we see this great big trends that are happening in the United States. I got mad at our own ethical culture movement because they said, well, the reason is because of this. And I'm saying the data doesn't really support that. What the data says is look across the United States, regardless of religious belief, economics, color of the people in the room, women dominated, men dominated, they're all plummeting by the exact same amount. So how can it be that one group is doing something very different from others? We're seeing demographic shifts across the United States. Now, Bob Putnam got his doctorate studying Italy and what happened in Italy around civic engagement. This is how he got to think, I wonder if I can apply the things I've learned in Italy to what I'm seeing in the United States. And what he did is he went there, and at the time, Italy was coming out of severe economic challenges. It's always been somewhat of a fractionist society. It's always had a very strong elements of communists and all these different groups, of course, within there. And what he did is he wanted to look at these groups, and he wanted to ask the question the Italian government had basically said, listen, we cannot afford to provide all these services that everybody needs to rebuild post-war Italy. We can't do it. What we're going to do is we're going to divide you up by your states, which is what you all already are, and we're going to hand you the money, and then you're going to have to make these things happen in your locale. Right, a very kind of a very nuts and bolts type approach. And so Bob said, wow, this is interesting. I'm gonna go study that, how effective those groups are. So he went to Italy, and sure enough, they had divided up, and he went to some places, and he looked at what they did. In some areas, they built schools, they built hospitals, they redid the infrastructure, there were all these kinds of things, and he looked in each Italian area, each of the kind of states of Italy, and looked at what they were doing and said, why were some so effective at doing this and others were not? So then he looked at economics. He said, yeah, the richer areas you would expect to have more money, right? Coming in, they'd have a larger tax base, they could do stuff. But he looked, and some of the richer areas were no better than some of the poor areas in providing services. In fact, some of the poorer areas were also just as effective at supplying services. So then he thought, wow, that's weird. That has very little to do with that. Then he looked at different kinds of beliefs and socioeconomics and went through these whole things, and he couldn't find the common ground. What is really the main driver? I see some correlations, but it just doesn't hold up one of them. And then he went to one area of Italy where he was doing his work there and noticed that there was a choir in a local church. And he came to find out that that choir had been meeting for 100 years or so. You know, there'd been a long time in Italy. And he found all these groups, and he found out that in that particular area, which was seen to be very, very successful at building schools and hospitals and libraries and providing infrastructure and attaining to public health and stuff, had large numbers of civic groups. And he coined a term we use now to describe that called social capital. He's the guy that came up with it, if you've heard that term before. And what he said is, some areas have large numbers of civic groups who are building the infrastructure, and other areas have maybe money, or they have the location, but they don't have the civic engagement. And he said, as soon as he mapped that out, the correlation was one-to-one. That was exactly what you'd expect to see. So that's why Bob Putnam wrote the book, Bowling Alone. He looked across the United States and says, wow, I'm seeing a massive drop in civic engagement that's happening. Americans were the civic engagement people. We actually led the way in many, many ways. I mean, that's how many of your parents belonged to some kind of a group, from anything from the Elks, the Moose, that maybe they belonged to some kind of communist group, whatever. How many of your parents were actively engaged as a civic groups when you were younger, right? There was quite a number of people who that's what they did. In fact, you're engaged in one right now. You're in this room with those kinds of stuff. So the first thing we have to realize is the shift in demographics nationwide. We're seeing people who are not joining groups, unless you're conservative. Now, what does that mean? Whose voice is going to be amplified? Who's going to get their acts together? Who's going to organize their people? Who's going to get the stuff out there? Who's going to have the protest marches? Who's going to influence politicians? Who's going to raise the money? The answer is conservatives, which is what they did. They outpaced us. What percentage of Americans consider themselves conservative? What percentage? Yeah, 17%. Call themselves conservatives. Americans call themselves moderates. I'm moderate, yeah. That's what most people say. I'm in between those kinds of stuff. What percentage of Americans consider themselves liberals? It's around 15 to 17%. Most Americans see themselves in the center. They don't see themselves as either of those kinds of stuff. They don't identify using those kinds of stuff. So the civic engagement is extremely important. And I think the first thing message I would have to do to you is to remember that you have a brick and mortar space sitting on the footprint of Central Park in the center of Manhattan, of the power you have to continue to use your space effectively. But it also means to shift in a couple of other ways that I want to speak about. I've happened to notice that your leader, Joe Schumann, has been teaching a philosophy class. Joe and I both have, he has a doctorate in philosophy. I have an undergraduate degree in philosophy, but I ended up teaching at Fairleigh Dickinson University, who reached out to me and said, hey, you're here, we hear you're in town, can you come teach? That's not usually what happens when universities. And I said, okay, I'd come teach. But what I love about Joe is I saw that, how many of you took his course, or how many are watching his little class? He did this thing on utilitarian and deontology and those kinds of stuff. He's going around the kind of traditional lineup for those things. Utilitarianism is a very, very interesting thing, right? If you look in the history of philosophy, if you go through the history of philosophy, the ideas of things like utilitarianism don't occur until recently, really speaking. In large numbers, right? We were by less what we would have divine command theory. God said it, you should do it, that's the end of the discussion. And that was basically ruled ethics for about 1,500 years in the West. A long period of time was the kind of the main things, which reason why we weren't good at it. Until people started to read actually more of the religious texts because of people like Martin Luther, who translated the Bible from Latin into German, into the vernacular. People had never read the Bible in the vernacular. He creates something else, by the way. How did he divide up the Bible so people could make sense and he could point to things? He created text and verse, a chapter, verse. He's the guy that put the little numbers on things like that, kind of screwed the whole system up because other people, like Jewish people, said, you divided books right in the middle, you know, or you put this on one here with stuff. And he didn't get it quite right, but it was brilliant because what he was trying to do is make the book accessible to people. The problem for many of the religious people is people actually started reading the book and they go, well, that's not what it says, or how come this is what here? No, this is important, all this kind of stuff. And it led eventually to couple of main factions at the beginning, the difference between the Roman Catholics, what we'll call them Catholic lights, the people who were protesting against the excesses of the Catholic Church, right? They all go then to the Council of Trent, they argue these things out, and eventually said the Catholics, the Roman Catholics said, you will adhere to our waned way of thinking or not. These other people said, well, why is there only supposed to be one bishop? It's supposed to be an equal bishop, right? We call it episcopacy. That when the Roman Empire was falling down, what they did, the Romans were getting like, oh my God, the Huns are coming. We need to do something. They divided their empire into 10 sees. Called a diocese, right? Dio, Latin word for 10, sees, put a bishop, which at that time was someone who was a great cavalry military leader in charge of that, and then kind of stepped out and they disappeared. And when they left Rome, where did they go? They went to answer the phone. That's where they went. Where did they go? The Roman Empire, the seat of the Roman Empire left and went where? Constantinople, right? After 1,000 years, they left Rome, went to Constantinople, right? And eventually Rome falls, all these things happen, you know, from history, and then all these equal bishops are trying to hold their territory together the best they can. Fast forward about 400 years, four or 500 years, and at this point, there were regional areas of Christianity. They were all building massive churches, right? The glory of God, so you had Notre Dame, which they just reopened the doors in Paris. There was up there in York, the cathedral. There was Canterbury. There was all these beautiful churches. And each of them had kind of a head priest who was kind of doing the area. Well, then the Romans said, well, we're the number one because we were the original Romans. And the rest of them said, what? No, you're not. He said, yeah, you are. You're going to call me Papa. You're going to call me the head, right? The Pope. We're going to call me that. And the rest of them said, no, we're not. So that kind of led to further divisions between Protestants and Catholics that also had a lot to do with philosophy. It had to do that the fact when the Roman church finally got its act back together again, they wanted to build an even bigger church And of course, that takes money. As any of you who've ever remodeled your kitchen here in New York City, it takes massive millions of dollars worth of money. So where did they go? What did they do to get that money? They sold get out of hell free cards, correct. They sold indulgences, get out of hell free cards, right? Because that's what they told people, you're gonna go to hell. And so people said, oh, here's my money. Can I get a get out of hell free card? And then other protesters said, no, that's crazy. That's not in the Bible, that's stupid. Forgiveness comes not with a price. And so that eventually explodes in Europe. Now you have two different groups fighting. They're fighting, the Protestants are fighting against the Catholics. Who was the most vicious of them all? Who came in and killed everybody and let God sort it out? The Swedes. They're so nice now. I think they're just paying for all those sins. But yeah, it was a really, really bad thing. And in between that is another Protestant a group of people who are saying, listen, we read this book. We don't even need a Eucharist. We could just read the Bible and go to heaven. We call them the Reformationists. Right, the Reformationists come and present this to the Catholics and Protestants. They look at them, go, kill them. And then everybody attacks them. And so they decide to get the hell out of Europe. Where did they go? They went to the United States, right? They got in the boats and in 1621? Can you remember now? We tell this story. It's about them. We tell American story based on that, even though there were lots of other Europeans living in America before that, and we tell their story. That's why how the power of that has stuff. But this period of time leads to massive warfare in Europe in a short period of time. We call the 30 Years' War. It wasn't 30 years long. It was kind of off and on type of thing. 15 to 25 million Europeans are dead. Heavily vicious battle. At the end of that, you had all these fractured states and all these little groups are trying to hold together. They say, listen, we're not going to fight over religion anymore, right? You have your belief, you have your belief. Let's just try and hold this together, because if not, we're going to lose our farms. We're going to lose everything that we have to these other invading armies. Let's just get it together. And so in that era, new ideas started to emerge that, listen, let's don't just build it on a on a monarchy or something like that. Jeremy Bentham starts writing and said, we just need a social contract. Let's just agree to get along, all right? So then what kind of society do we want? And this is what he said, well, we want a society that allows for everybody just to be happy, to have the maximum amount of pleasure, right? He called it the hedonic calculus. That's all we need to do. We could just figure out what brings the most happy for a lot of other people. And of course, that doesn't work because people think, well, we don't want to make it just about pleasure, right? We want to make it about other things. We want to make it about what's called utility, which is, let's just create that a contract, social contract, which like a constitution, right, where we all get together and we would do it where people can have utility, which is the greatest good for the greatest number of people. And so sure enough, in our Declaration of Independence, we hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal. Men, I'm sorry, Rich, you did miss out, and that'd be white males, are created equal and endowed by their creator for certain unalienable rights, among them, life, liberty, and what? We're going to stick a little hedonic calculus in there for good measure. But yeah, life and liberty, pursuit of happiness. So we have a social contract theory. And that becomes a very, very powerful thing. Jean-Jacques Rousseau picks that up when he goes to France. The French begin to do this. Lots of different groups of people. John Stuart Mill is eventually going to perfect this. But of course, during Jeremy Bentham's day, he's influencing the French and in the English. They're starting to write constitutions and social contract theories about how we can just create the best good that's not based on a set of beliefs, but just about a set of kind of rules about how we will engage and protect our own kind of joint assets. And things like that. Thomas Jefferson is traveling in France. He's the ambassador to France, right? He's still looking at all this stuff. He gets influenced by a lot of these ideas and brings them back. And then working with Madison and some others, of course, we have the Constitution we have today, which is a hodgepodge of lots of different kinds of belief systems. Now, if you took Joe's class, the greatest good for the greatest number of people works for a lot of systems. It works pretty good. Right? Because we can collectively try to build things that we need. Well, what do we need? We need schools, we need education, we need these kinds of things. We can work together to build the greatest good for the greatest number of people. But it led other philosophers to say, I see that you're doing things where it's the greatest good maybe for the greatest number, but not the best good for everyone. right? When Jane Jacobs here in New York City had her fight with Robert Moses about he thought the greatest good for New York City was to, for commerce, was really to knock down some of these houses and put giant freeways out so commerce could flow easily into this area, right? That was that big struggle out here. It's fine, and of course makes, supposedly was supposed to make New York City this big powerhouse of economics. To a certain extent, it remained it. Jane Jacobs said, no, that's ridiculous. You're not going to do that. And she stops him from doing all that stuff. But people paid the price all through places like the Bronx, where they really went and said, ah, let's put a highway right through here. Let's put a highway here. Let's put a bridge here. When I first came up here from South Texas, it always blew my mind that you could get on a major highway and come across and end at a stop sign, make a right turn at another stop sign, another stop sign. That's always thought, told my friends about what Manhattan is like. It's like there's no really easy way to make it even. Think about trying to go from here to Long, from Jersey to Long Island, right? It's like, forget about it. You got to do all these kind of stuff. That's why they have that sign in Brooklyn when you get there to remind you, forget about it. It's not going to happen. So these, all these things are kind of going on, and it lends itself to a set of problems we call in philosophy, grouped together frequently called trolley car problems. You've all heard this thing. You're standing there at a switch. There's a trolley car coming really quickly. You didn't expect it. There are two tracks. On one track are about five workers working with their back to you. Over here is just one, and you're standing there with the switch. What do you do? How many are you going to pull the switch and kill the one to save the five? The rest of you are cheating, right? So, right, we hate these kinds of horrible, disgusting problems. People say, well, I reorganize and remanufacture. You're missing the main point of this, which is, which atrocities would you allow for in order to have the greatest good for the greatest number of people, right? If you sacrifice one for five, will you sacrifice 10 for 100? Will you sacrifice 1,000 for 10,000? Will you sacrifice 1 million for 5 million? And sure enough, that's been the history in the West, where sometimes we rain down bombs on people in the interest of peace. Now, that trolley car problems eventually led to a lot of philosophers trying to figure out how to fix that system here and there, and it kind of broke into two groups. Generally, in the speaking, political scientists don't use these divisions much anymore, but one is a group of populists. Like, it's still supposed to be the greatest good for the greatest number of people, versus others who say, no, we're pluralists. There are some reasons why even upholding the rights of the few can benefit, hopefully over time, the rights of the many. That division we have in the United States between populist movements and pluralist movements, right? And those are kind of the arguments that are often presented. What is the greatest good for the greatest number of people? What is the thing to do that? And the messaging struggle, my first little thing to you that, that progressive organizations often have, is we do believe that a diverse society, that upholding the rights of the few, can have a profound long-term benefit for the rights of the many as well, right? Those preserving those kinds of beliefs and things like that. But for a lot of people, it's like, well, you're saying I need to sacrifice my future because this small group of people have been historically oppressed or down, and they've opted to say, I don't buy your argument for that, right? The challenge we often have in our movement is we forget the importance of creating a message that resonates for both groups, the pluralist and the populist. You cannot build a future based, and I'm saying that you did that in this room, you cannot build a future based on just serving the needs of the great majority of people or on just the needs of the smallest group without somehow finding a message that resonates together. And that became a very, very, very powerful tool on the right. Right? They're coming to take away our jobs. They're going to displace us. They're eating our cats and dogs. You know, they, all these things are happening. And part of what's happening is the idea is to repeat the message over and over and again that they, progressives, forgot about you. Because we were so nuancing our own belief in pluralism and the benefits of pluralism, we forgot how to create a message that incorporated everybody in the room, not just a few people in the room. I see that with a lot of progressive groups when they're saying, and it's one of the reasons I had a fight with the American Ethical Union, is to come in and say, you know, you're just a bunch of patriarchal white supremacists, and you need to get over that in order to do that. Well, that's a really strange message. How do I get behind that kind of a message? How do I get behind something that's fracturous, that pulls people apart? And I see progressive movements do that time and time again. Your first little message is create messages which are about all of us, everybody, the best way you can. And that message has to resonate deeply. And the subtle nuances like, oh, this is good for you in the long term, lose out to, I'm gonna give you a check in the short term, every time, right? If you look at the rules of poker, you know, one pair beats in nothing, two pair beats one pair. Immediate gratification for large numbers of people beats out nuanced, this is good for us in the long term type of things over every time. The second thing I want to talk about is Antonio Damasio. Is anyone a fan of his stuff? Probably most people, maybe only a few people have ever even heard of him. Antonio Damasio is an Italian neurologist who wrote a really bunch of really cool books. I'm a big fan of his because I think he gets some of this stuff exactly right. He's in Italy, once again, he's not an American, he's a neuroscientist. And basically, he says lots of very famous books. His first famous book is The Feeling of What Happens, is to remember how important it is to use our emotions with our cognitive ability. You know, when you're born, you have your emotional part of your brain and you have your logical part of the brain, and at what age do the final bridges between all those fuse together? So, 25, right? Which is why when you look at your kids, and you also went through that yourself, people looking at you're just leading with your emotions, stop and think about this. Now, youth can stop and think about things, but those two parts of the brains are not connected. When I was a kid, I loved Star Trek. I thought, I want to be just like Spock. How many of you wanted to be Spock? All right, how many of you don't even know what Star Trek is? Okay, good. Because I told my college students at FDU about Spock, and they all went, who's Spock? I'm like, get the hell out of here. But, you know, Spock, right, they were supposedly the Vulcans were this species whose emotions were so strong, they were killing each other for thousands of years, and so they decided to rein in their emotions and let their logical side preside. So that's the backstory for those of you who are fanboys like me. And then that's what Spock wanted to do. He was raised in a culture that never kind of valued emotions until he encountered humans and the struggling with that. But in that story, basically is the idea that if we were all just logical, everything would be fine, right? And the problem with that is it's absolutely no true. That's what Antonio Damasio figured out. He says, actually, he studied a guy who had prefrontal cortex damage, a rebar went through his brain. And this guy was smart, intelligent, did extremely well, had a great job, had a lovely family, happy wife, happy home. It started after that, even though he passed all the cognitive tests, they have him in the hospital and they're doing all this stuff, the guy scores perfectly well, they said, you're cured, and then his life went to hell. And Antonio Damasio says, I want to study this guy. What's going on here? Sure enough, gives him all these battery of tests. Logically, this guy could do all kinds of stuff. Exactly correct, right? But he also cried if he saw like a puppy just walk across the floor or laughed at a funeral or did something like that. His emotions no longer matched anymore. And this is what Antonio Damasio started his original idea in his research is, do we need our emotions in order to improve our cognitive ability? And the answer is yes. So Daniel Goldman, all those people after them wrote books like Emotional Intelligence, wrote those books. You need your emotions. We could take all the people and study that they have studied, and they found out that people who are, shall we say, the more emotionally stunted or just not in touch with their emotions actually perform worse on cognitive ability tests than other people. That's why we remember that, unfortunately, because he was probably, or she was probably bullied in school, but that super smart kid, but they had no street smarts and that kind of stuff, and therefore, you look at them today and they didn't go as far as they could have gone. We need our emotions. We need our emotions. Our emotions are like our radar, right? That's how we perceive the environment, is through our emotions, and saying that we just need to be logical without really developing our emotional side disconnects those kinds of stuff. That's why it's so important that you, when you're working with groups or doing counseling, I sit there sometimes, I'm listening for emotive language. How often do they use emotional words, right? How often are you raised in households when mom and dad had a fight, they locked the door and went away and never expressed their emotions? And if you were exposed to it, they told you, calm down, you shouldn't do that. Or what we do to young boys, which is the most horrific thing you could do to anyone, is to say, don't cry if you get hurt, right? Watch a game of soccer. I had a chance to go watch my niece playing soccer, and she's out there in this field, and one little girl gets hurt, she starts to cry, the entire game stops, and they all run over there to help her, walk her off the field. Unfortunately, that's changing more and more, but these women, these young girls gather around this young lady. A little boy falls down on the field, and you step on his back on the way to the ball, right? That's that kind of thing, and if he cries, then people look at him and say, don't cry, you're not supposed to cry. There's no crying in sports, no crying in baseball. Remember that ridiculous, funny line? So Antonio Damasio says, the first thing is remember that we need our emotions. Our emotional intelligence is often a gauge about our ability to do rational things. And just saying to people that you need to be logical is not enough. You cut us off from kind of the deep patterns. But that's not the book I want to talk about. The second book he wrote is called The Strange Order of Things. And he basically, now we have neuroscience, all this just recently, we could put encephalograms in people's heads and we can read their brains and what lights up, and even more now with magnetic resonance imaging, we don't even have to do these electrodes and all this stuff. And he's looking at why people respond to certain things. Why do some people, what parts of the brain light up for this? And he's going through and he's showing them all these images and, you know, pictures of t-shirts or pictures of puppies and different parts of your brains are lighting up. Maybe the memory center, cognitives, everything. And then occasionally he saw a picture or a word or something and it would light up very deep inside of us. Way deep, down hypothalamus deep, or just kind of deep-seated thing. And he thought, that's interesting. He kept doing this and sure enough, certain ideas, concepts, and images resonate deeply within us. And he looked at them and he said they're all kind of around homeostasis. They're all around that our ability as a species to keep ourselves together and whole and moving forward, even though it's a changing environment. And it resonates around several important things. Around safety is one of them, right? That's what triggers your fight or flight. It goes extremely deep. You don't just think, oh, should I run away from this bear or not? If I calculate the trajectory, no. These are so deep, they resonate deep inside of us, right? Around food scarcity, around shelter. And every time he kind of threw out ideas like that, very deep in our brains, these things would light up. And so he made a prediction looking at Italian politics that if a politician speaks and uses words that triggers the deep structures as opposed to just the cognitively nuanced parts of our brains, who would probably be the more effective speaker? Let's see, they're coming here to take our jobs. This is an invasion. You're not safe. They're nothing more than rapists. They're eating your cats and dogs and you love your cats and dogs. Or versus, you know, if we can just keep inflation in check by making sure that we raise interest rates slightly and over the time it's going to work out. Which of those two ideas or concepts is going to light up the hypothalamus? Yeah. So the deeper kind of things like that and speaking to that. Now he's writing about Italian politicians. I can only imagine what Antonio Damasio is thinking about things. But if you have politicians who are out there talking about all these kind of really, really powerful things around food, safety, shelter, and the other side is a little bit too nuanced, I'll tell you whose message is going to resonate, unfortunately. By the way, that's what autocrats and dictators have figured out, that if I just speak to those things and blame another person for doing those things, then I'm gonna get double score because now I even have an object for us to go after in order to do this. Hence, welcome to today. So, but there's something really important about that. If I don't pay attention to safety, if I don't pay attention to food, if I don't pay attention to shelter, what am I paying attention to? if I'm not paying attention to these very, very deep needs within our societies, we run the risk of a message that's not as relevant to people who don't translate all through these nuances of the policies and money changes and things like this, and how that long-term can impact things. Right, when I work with my young adults, of course, I want to prepare the next generation for dealing with major challenges that are going to be coming from climate change. Right, I don't think it's supposed to be 80 degrees in November, am I correct, in New York? Now, when I first came up here, and that wasn't that long ago, I remember it snowed before Halloween. And now it was 81 degrees on October 31st, and it was 80 after that. So I can either worry kids and go through all this advocacy and talk about all this good stuff, or I could just give them the tools they need to confront the challenges of the future. And I've chose the other one for lots of other reasons. But thinking back to that message, it reminds me of Felix Adler when the work that he did. Actually, what Adler said is that we need to focus on the worth and dignity of the person. Do they have a job? Do they have skills? Do they have food on the table? Do we have a nurse? Are they sick and those kind of stuff? And what Adler originally did in an institution is to focus on those things, right? That we would create the Society for an Ethical Culture was to make sure that the work that we're doing out there elicited not just the best of the people through some kind of, you know, spiritual whatever they're supposed to be, but to just address the worth and dignity of a human to have a right to a meal. Do you know, I live in Jersey City on a boat because I can't afford to live in anywhere else. I live on my boat and I drive 22 miles to Teaneck, New Jersey. My tolls are $400 a month. It costs me $400 a month to go 23 miles. I cannot afford to live in the neighborhood. I went, when I first got here, I said, wow, man, Bergen's paying me really well. I should go look for a house. And I walked in the door and there were 10 people saying, I'll pay $90,000 more than that. Forget about it. You know, your average home price in Teaneck, New Jersey starts at $500,000 and goes up from there. And this is Jersey? I knew they would get a chuckle. I love Jersey, the second most educated state in the United States after Massachusetts. New Jersey's phenomenal. People are wonderful. They do so many things right. Education, environment. They're providing this big, gigantic, massive groups of people with all this infrastructure. And they do some of it very, very well. They do other things pretty shitty, but they do some, a lot of stuff pretty well. So I think the thing is to never forget that basic message. You know, I just taught a workshop. We did our third workshop on the confronting the youth mental health crisis here in the United States. And that was just this past Wednesday. So our first one was on youth mental health first aid. The second one is what to do in case of drug overdose and how to use Narcan. I hope you have a Narcan kit somewhere in your house or in your car or in your purse right now. And the third that we just did are on adverse childhood experiences and trauma-informed community practices, which is the thing I teach for the National Park Service in 2 weeks. And what's important about that is to focus on some very basic things. How do you mitigate against adverse childhood experiences? That was based on that Kaiser Permanente study. They went and they looked at all these kids, these adults who were chronically ill in hospitals, and they were trying to figure out why do certain people chronically appear in hospitals. And they did this research until Nadine Burke-Harris started to look at, say, maybe it had something to do with their childhood. She asked them a bunch of childhood questions, and sure enough, they all had a large number of adverse childhood experiences, which could be just your parents got divorced, but it could also be, was there alcoholism in the home? Did someone hit you? Yeah, we all yell and hit, and kids get hurt in households. The difference is, did you leave them alone with that hurt, right? That's the difference between that, because we see kids get hurt, we immediately go to them and try to do that. So all these things are going on, and Nadine says that if you have a certain percentage of these things, you're probably going to carry these with you the rest of your life unless you deal with them, right? You have to unpack all that. You have to change all that. I know firsthand experience with someone I love who had 8 of the 10, and I know that his life was a complete struggle after that. These things really are real types of things. So trauma-informed community practices are just a way for us to plan activities within communities and make sure people know, do I feel safe? All kinds of safety. Do I feel calm? There's all different kinds of ways to do that. Do I feel included? Do I have some control over my environment? right? Which is another really important thing that everybody wants. Do I understand the world around me? Am I hopeful about the future? And do I have a pathway to get there? And by the way, if you ask kids today, those answers, the answers are pretty depressing. 56% of young ladies no longer feel, have, young girls are facing depression, anxiety. So we have to address those very, very, very deep structures in order to do that. Here's the thing that I want to say. You can do all those things. Those within our capacity, those are the things that are within with our religion, those are the tools at our hand. We can rebuild all these things. We can create messages for everyone. We can address the basic kind of homeostatic needs of all. We can confront civic engagement and make sure that those things are not happening, and it works. I told you that I'm just a carpenter, a construction, and a plumber. I see myself more like that sometimes than anything else. Because when I went into the Bergen Society, I basically said, listen, some people said we need to focus on this or focus on that. And I said, let's just go back to the basics. Can we pay the bills? Do we have money for programming? And luckily, I'm happy to report that after 3 years of work, we now have a balanced budget. In fact, we balanced our budget October 27th when we had our haunted house event. With 156 people came out in the neighborhood for our 100 house, and now we're just raising money. We did that by raising $75,000 within a couple of years to provide job training for young adults by addressing many of the types of things, everything from drugs addictions and providing services for outside group, and in addition raised another $200,000 now to remodel our building, right? So we just raised all this money within 3 years. I work with 56 nonprofits this year in order to do so. Every Wednesday, second Wednesday of the month, all of these nonprofits show up and I say, here's how to raise money. Here's how to do this. Right? You could focus on all these other things and messaging and all these problems, or we can address the basic needs of people wherever they are, which is what I think ethical culture started with at the beginning. Things are not bad. Things are actually pretty good. The fact that we have still a functioning society. I'm not Pollyannish. I'm not forgetting about things. I am as worried as you are about things like democracy, but I also know that we are a highly contextual species, and we can sit in a room and wring our hands and worry about things, or we can actually build the infrastructure we need to change those things around. I'd rather just be in that second camp. Not that I don't appreciate the first, but my hands hurt from doing this too much. So I've stopped doing that. I'd rather my hands hurt from banging hammers and kind of stuff. Progressive groups don't fail. Progressive groups just sometimes forget that the world has shifted out from underneath them, and they just need to re-shift with those times and be responsive to the types of messages that we're putting out there. Thank y'all so much.
We have time for Q&A. Questions?
Thank you. Curt, thanks so much for your message. So many questions come up. So as a self-identifying progressive, my name's David, I'm wondering about things like the proposed Green New Deal. Years ago, Bernie Sanders, AOC, and maybe a few others. How do we make climate messaging the climate is ultimately going to affect all of us, no matter where we live, obviously, right? So how can we create effective messaging to really strongly confront a crisis that is already affecting a lot of, everybody? The Green New Deal seems to address part of what you're talking about, the sense that progressives don't take the needs and the desires, the deeply emotionally rooted desires of everybody into account. A Green New Deal proposes that we build out a renewable energy system, among other things, that will create a lot of great green new jobs, well-paying jobs, safer than building, gas and oil infrastructure in any case, and will assure a future, a livable planet for all of our kids. That's it.
Oh, I'm right with you 100%. I mean, part of that is, and part of what I do is I scan the internet every single month for grants and keep on top of that. And in addition, because I work with the National Park Service, I'm a contractor for the National Park Service, I see where funding initiatives have. For 17 years, I was the National Youth Program Director for an organization created by the National Park Service and the EPA up until just 3 years ago, and was looking at where all the funding. Funding is going for innovation, right? The challenges we have with our young adults is we have this massive kind of things that are coming our way, but we need to innovate the heck out of this. If you watch the movie The Martian, remember he gets stuck on the planet, and one of the things he says, I got a science to shit out of this. Excuse my French, but that's what he says. And I believe the same thing. Innovation is going to be extremely important. The problem is you got to be able to innovate and create jobs that exist. And we haven't been able to do that enough in the green economy. We need to do it. I totally 100% agree with AOC and others that this should be what we did. By the way, they're just parroting scientists who I'm actually listening to, who are saying the same thing. The thing we could do is offer innovation, right? How can we innovate a new economy? How can we change this? New Jersey is phenomenal. They have this massive infrastructure, and it's all sitting on display. When I drive from Jersey City, I see big transportation things. I see major airports. I see giant buildings with supercomputer hubs inside of there that are supplying all this data for Manhattan. I see water filtration sites. I see energy, you know, as you come up the corridor, you see even refineries, and you see windmills, and you see all this stuff. Jersey is doing everything they can. We are here in their level of production to the demand, to the total demand, right? Which means they cannot even keep up with all the massive demand of 18 million people in the metro area. And this is what led several different people who are technologists to say, unless we have clean, affordable energy, you cannot build a future. We need more energy. We don't need polluting energy, but don't kid yourself, we need energy. Right, we need green energies for all this kind of stuff. We don't have the infrastructure yet for that. We don't have the technologies that are out there enough. We're not funding these projects. There has to be this, all this stuff. That's why it makes it so complicated. So take your average little citizen living in some small town. One of the reasons why they'll never participate in that part of the economy is the amount of energy that's needed in close proximity as we try to do this. So we could do it. We just had to find these ways to engage people in meaningful projects from the beginning. What I do is do job training every summer. I've done job training every summer for almost 18 years now. And that's just to make sure that those kids have the skills they have for self-determining their lives. But if you're living in a municipal housing site somewhere in Yonkers, like when I first started working, and you can't even paint your wall, it's extremely disempowering. We have to help our children understand that this is just Play-Doh. All of this can be changed. We can take this wall down and move it over here. We can open up things. This is Play-Doh. The only thing that stops us is will. And that's the kind of thing that we have to build in both of that. Providing the skills, creating new innovation, funding college and those kinds of insights, creating career pathways for people to get in those jobs because those career pathways do not exist to the extent that they are now, and then also changing the economy. Yes, sir.
Many years ago, I attended a presentation by Ralph Nader, and he ended the presentation saying, you know, all you college people, here's what you should do. Find the worst corporations in America, get a job there, change them from within. So we now have the most complex of all trolley questions coming up. I'm looking especially at Agenda 47. The version of Project 2050 that Trump says he is backing. And there's a lot of horrible things on there. And it's going to change the education system, how money is found, getting rid of teacher tenure forever are some of the goals. There's going to be a massive number of committees and organizations that are going to have to be set up to make this agenda work. When those committees show up, do we run away from them or towards them?
You know, the thing I feel about all of this stuff is what Americans want is they want their basic needs met. We're very, very pragmatic, Americans are. It's not about the America. It's not about ideas and good stuff. It's about, do I have food on the table? Think about that. Your average kid graduating from college today has $60,000 in debt. They can't even afford to have a car, because stuff. Many of you know that your own kids are still living with you, and all these challenges they have to even get to these types of places. They can try and put forth all of these ideas. We try to put forth all of these ideas, and what Americans want is the thing in the middle of the context of making sure that we have food on the table, we have these things. Their message will fail if they make it too ideological. Their message will fail if they make it too ideological. They made it just about food on the table. We should be talking about food on the table. We should be able to talk about affordability. We should talk about lowering the cost of college and all this other kind of stuff too. I think as long as we continue to do that, then people stop looking this direction and start looking this way again. Because ultimately, I think that's where middle America is. So I'm not interested really in the ideologies. Ideologies always lose. It's who's actually going to deliver the goods. So I'm not saying that they can't go in and wreck a bunch of stuff. But I also know that as for when I listen to politicians, some things that really matter deeply to us are so entrenched in our Constitution that would probably never happen. So we'll see, because we're all going to sue the crap out of them if they try to do things. So that's what we do. So I hear their ideologies. I hear all their dark things that, you know, they're talking about kind of stuff. And I also hear some of the things where we say, well, we need to do this just for this group of people. And I'm like, man, if you're not talking to the middle, you're not talking to America. And many of us who come from places like rural South Texas and all have families at that, I think that's what they paid attention to. And I say things like Project 25 and they go, what? They don't know what those things are. So if there's any hope, I think as long as we understand that the importance of our message, of recrafting that message, we do believe in a diverse thing. Diversity has made us strong. We believe in education. Education elevated us to the moon. We do believe in all of these things. We can innovate the heck out of the economy and continue to lead. But it just can't be about ideologies. Those won't win. We have to find ways to just make those things happen, build those in there, and people are very contextual. That's the direction they'll go, in my opinion.
We have time for one more question. Hi, Curt. When you talked about the decline of civic engagement, it seemed to correspond chronologically to the rise of internet usage, and I'm just curious on your thoughts around that.
Throw your phones away today. Imagine if I created a device that immediately fed dopamine into your brain, like an addict. Would you sit there all day long?
And do this.
Right? That's what this is. This is a dopamine delivery system. Right? And it feeds those very, very deep things, especially around outrage. That's how people make money. I read an article about a very, very liberal progressive guy in Maine who wrote all this misinformation crap. And he says, well, that's how I make my money. And because people like dopamine, that's why we all watch cat videos, right? Or dog videos. Did you see the one where the baby panda sneezed and the mom went like this? It was hysterical. Yeah, so those little happy moments in our brain are addictive. And there's a great thing that's going around, you can Google this, which shows where people spent their time and attention. Did it make it away through this community too? Most progressive groups. And what it is, it's a scientist who went from 1950s and said, where do people, and as it progressives, you could see sometimes it was the church, sometimes it was education, and what kind of stuff, and then until we got to recently where the internet was invented, and then it went from, you know, most of these things were about 20-30% of the time to where now the internet is about 67% of our attention. Absolutely correct. If we haven't figured out to create community out of this. I'm not sure the science is not quite there that it's damaging and causing depression in young ladies. I think it is. Stop that. But, we don't really know. That's the thing we have to be talking about. That's the smart things that we can, as progressives, be trying to figure out. Because when we use those messages, other families are saying, oh my God, I'm seeing depression in my young ladies as well. There's so much mental health crisis in young families. It's just scary. And so that's where we can reclaim them. We have to go back and talk to the basic needs, and taking care of your children runs extremely deep within us. Probably the deepest of anything. So hopefully we can. Thank you all.